take your Bible tonight. You got to get this right, Dean, okay? Got it? Romans chapter 12, please. Romans chapter 12 for our scripture tonight. It's good to see Mrs. Linke here this evening from New York. Glad to have you visiting tonight. Brett's mom. Romans chapter 12, please. I'm going to begin reading in verse 17. Follow along with me, if you will. The Bible says, "Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, Vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good." Now, Father, add your blessing to the reading of our scripture here tonight. And, Lord, I'm asking you to open our understanding as we look into your word this evening. Spirit of God, be our teacher tonight. And we yield ourselves to you, and we ask you to help us to know the word of God and to rightly divide your word tonight, and help us to understand exactly what you meant when you gave us this command of be not overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. Bless our study here this evening in Jesus' name. Amen. Of all the people, listen carefully now, of all the people in your life to this point that you would say has hurt you the most, who comes to your mind? Who's wounded you? Who's lied about you? Who gossiped about you? Who walked out on you? Who took your money? Who abused you when you were younger? Who's been ungrateful to you? Who maybe has humiliated you in front of other people? Who said things about you, maybe even to people at church, that caused you great hurt and great pain? Maybe a situation where they made it to be you were the person at fault and you really weren't the person at fault. Who betrayed you? Now, I'm not trying to get you to pull off a scab where God's already begun to heal. But I want you to think about something. Everybody has things that have happened to them in their life that have hurt them deeply and injured them deeply. Evil happens to all of us. I don't remember when it was. I remember bringing a study about deliver us from evil. Remember that message? Some of you do. And evil, if you remember, we sometimes use sin and evil interchangeably, but that's not true. Evil is when there's an alliance to bring harm to another person. And whenever there's an alliance, by the way, when someone wants to do harm to another person, you say, well, yeah, who's their alliance with? You tell me. Satan. He's to kill, steal, and destroy. And when we become an accuser of the brethren, we're in alliance with Satan. We go with him to try to destroy somebody else. Tonight, we'll look at how we're supposed to respond to evil. Things done to harm us. Things done intended to hurt us or wound us. And by the way, it won't get any easier. 2 Timothy chapter 3 says, "This know also, then last days, evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse." Won't get any easier. And so we have to learn how to handle evil. And here in Romans 12 are some very practical things that God tells us about when evil comes to us. Number one, I want you to notice we're not to return evil for evil. Notice verse 17, recompense, and that means repay or return an equivalent to no man evil for evil. Now, hold your finger there or put a piece of paper in Romans 12 because we're going to come back to that. But I want you to turn to the Old Testament for a moment, if you would, to 1 Samuel 25. Would you go back to 1 Samuel and chapter 25? Notice with me 1 Samuel 25 and verse number 2. There was a man in Maon whose possessions were in Carmel, and the man was very great. He had 3,000 sheep and 1,000 goats, and he was shearing his sheep in Carmel. Now the name of the man was Nabal, and the name of his wife Abigail, and she was a woman of good understanding and of a beautiful countenance. But the man was churlish, evil in his doings, and he was of the house of Caleb. And David heard in the wilderness that Nabal did shear his sheep. David sent out 10 young men. David said unto the young men, get you up to Carmel and go to Nabal. Greet him in my name. Thus shall ye say to him that liveth in prosperity, peace be both to thee and peace be to thine house. Peace be to all that thou hast. And now I've heard that thou hast shearers. Now thy shepherds which were with us, we hurt them not. Neither was there aught missing unto them all the while they were in Carmel. Ask thy young men, and they will show thee. Wherefore, let the young men find favor in thine eyes, for we come in a good day. Give, I pray thee, whatsoever cometh into thy hand, unto thy servants and to thy son David. And when David's young men came, they spake to Nabal, according to all the words in the name of David, and ceased. And Nabal answered David's servants, and said, who is David? And who is the son of Jesse? There be many servants nowadays that break away every man from his master. Shall I then take my bread and my water and my flesh that I have killed for my shearers and give it unto men whom I know not whence they be? And David's young men turned their way and went again and came and told him all these sayings. And David said unto his men, gird ye every man his sword. They girded on every man his sword, and David also girded on his sword. And there went up after David about 400 men and 200 abode by the stuff. Now, I'm going to stop there. Some of you know the rest of the story. But what I'm illustrating here is a classic example of David, by the way, who was a man after God's own heart. But David, who is preparing to return evil for evil. Nabal was an evil man, and he treats the 10 servants that David sends up there very roughly, won't help them, won't give them anything. In fact, throws a lot of disparaging things on David's name, that he's broken away from his master, and who is he anyway? He's nobody. I'm not going to give him anything. And David said, boys, we're taking care of business. And 400 guys said, let's go get him. And the good thing is, a young man hears of it. He goes and tells Abigail. Abigail makes a big feast, all kinds of food, and she comes and she begs him not to do this. I mean, basically David said, and there's some strong language in 1 Samuel 25, but basically David is saying, I won't leave anybody left. There won't be a man left when I'm done. And Abigail intercedes and keeps David from returning evil for evil and keeps him from that. And so we're going to find out how God took care of that, and maybe we'll refer back to that in just a little bit. So keep that in mind with when we talk about not returning evil for evil. What I'm saying is this, listen, if that could happen to David, do you think it could happen to you or me? Just that quick, boy, somebody does something, boy, we're ready to retaliate, we're ready to get even. I don't get mad, I get even. See? And we get ready to get right on that level of going evil for evil. You might be like the one neighbor whose phone rang at 3 a.m. Said, this is your neighbor, Mr. Smith. Your dog is barking and keeping me awake. The fellow said, well, thank you, I appreciate it, and hung up. The next morning, the neighbor's telephone rang at 3 a.m. He said, "This is Mr. Jones, lives next door. I don't have a dog." Waited till 3 a.m. to call him back. You know why? Evil for evil. Don't, when you let your adversary make you evil, he is the victor. When you allow them, listen, you can't let someone else's sin, someone else's evil, control your emotions and make you get into anger or misery or depression and all because of their evil. You know what happens then? You've been overcome by their evil. You've been overcome with evil. You don't have to be overcome that way. Boy, that goes against the victim mentality of our day. People feel like they do something evil, they do something that's bad, and you know what they do? Blame it on somebody else. Well, it's because this happened to me, or it's because that happened to me, or because that person said this. And we want to blame it on someone else. And now it's okay for them to do evil. Paul said, don't be overcome by evil. When I allow someone else's evil to influence me and my emotions and my reactions and how I respond, then I'm not only overcome of evil, I've given them power over me that they ought not to have. Christ is my king. Christ is my leader. Christ is the one who governs my life, not somebody else. When I allow someone else to do that, I'm saying, well, they've taken the place of Christ in my life. Because I'm doing what they want instead of what I know Christ says I should do. You have to make sure people don't control you because you're only to be controlled by Christ. Christ is the one who dictates my attitudes and my actions, not another human being. And that's certainly different than the way many people react, is it not? We let our emotions and our thoughts and our actions, and what it is sometimes, it's almost a reflex depending on how someone has treated us. And we somehow excuse it and think it's okay. Because, boy, if they raise their voice at me, well, then I'll just raise my... You got to fight fire with fire. Where's that again? I wasn't quite sure where that scripture was. Now, you're overcome of evil. Don't be overcome by evil. When Christ is the dominant reality in our life, we do not respond to other people's evil. When evil comes, listen, Christian, you don't respond to the evil, you respond to Christ. And He responds to the evil. Let the Lord Jesus deal with that, not you. He'll do a lot better job than we do. Don't let your enemy's hostility make you hostile. Don't let his anger make you angry. Don't let their flesh put you in the flesh. To repay evil for evil is to be overcome by evil. That's never the Christian's response. Boy, it's quiet in here tonight. Maybe this will help. I read this week. During one of the wars, a military unit, Brother Woods, you'll like this. A military unit hired a local boy to cook and clean for him. But of course, they were a bunch of jokesters, and so they quickly took advantage of the boy's naivety. He's just a little slow, you know. And so they smeared Vaseline on the stove handles. When he'd go to turn the stove on, he'd get his hands all gooey, and they would put buckets of water over the door, so when he'd open the door, he'd get doused with water. One night, they nailed his shoes to the floor, got up, couldn't move his shoes, and he never said a word about it. He took the brunt of all those jokes and never said a word, just would smile at him. Well, finally, the men started feeling guilty about what they were doing. And so they went to the boy and they said, we want to apologize for what we've been doing. We think they're pretty funny, but it really hasn't been funny. And we're sorry. We're not going to take advantage of you again. And the boy looked at him. He said, well, no more Vaseline on the stove? They said, no. No more Vaseline on the stove. No more water over the door? No. No more water over the door. He said, okay. No more nailing my shoes to the floor? No. No more nailing your shoes to the floor. And then a big smile came on his face. And he said, okay, no more spit in the soup. Evil for evil, okay? Don't do that. Now you're awake, aren't you? All right. Let me give you number two. We are not only not to have evil for evil, we're not to seek vengeance for evil. We are not to seek vengeance for evil. Verse 19 of Romans 12. Verse 19 of Romans 12. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, neither give, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. Luke 9. Would you turn to Luke 9, please? Luke chapter 9. Matthew, Mark, Luke. Luke 9, look at verse number 51 with me, will you please? Luke 9 and verse number 51. It came to pass, when the time was come that he, that's Jesus, should be received up, he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem. And he sent messengers before his face, and they went and entered into a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him. And they did not receive him, because his face was as though he would go to Jerusalem. When his disciples, James and John, saw this, they said, Lord, wilt thou that we command fire to come down from heaven and consume them, even as Elias did? But he turned and rebuked them and said, ye know not what manner of spirit ye are of. So he's going near a village there of Samaria, and he is going to Jerusalem, but he wants to stay there in that village, and they didn't want to receive him because they felt like he wanted to go on. And when they knew that they didn't want to receive him, James and John get upset. We would say they got ticked off. And they say, we'll fix this. Lord, you remember James and John, the sons of thunder, you know. Lord, we have fire come down from heaven and devour them all. How would that be? Wow. That's unbelievable. And they were saying, God, let's just judge them right now. And Jesus had to rebuke them and say, you don't know what kind of spirit you're of. Notice what verse 56 says. For the Son of Man is not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. And they went to another village. Wonder, listen, when you get that attitude of vengeance, do you really? You have to ask yourself, why do I want to destroy somebody else's life? If I want to destroy somebody else, then I'm not having the spirit that Jesus Christ has. Jesus isn't here to try to destroy people's lives. He's here to save people's lives. To help people in their lives. And so we can't take vengeance like they wanted to do. How about in the garden when the Judas leads them to come get Jesus? And Peter finally wakes up from sleeping instead of praying. And when he sees the commotion going on, maybe still half asleep, we don't know. Remember what he does? Grabs his sword and starts hacking, doesn't he? And he chopped a guy's ear off. Jesus had to rebuke Peter. Say, man, what? And you think about that. Here's a fisherman, one guy with a sword, and here's all these soldiers. What was Peter thinking? He had no hope. And of course, Jesus rebuked him, and you remember what he did? He picked that ear up and put it back on the guy's head. fixed it for. Pretty amazing. Said Peter, those who, remember, pick up the sword will perish by the sword. When Jesus was smitten by the high priest, he didn't answer a word. He could have. He outranked the high priest. He's the Lord of Lords. But he remained quiet. No vengeance for evil. Do you understand? That's, you say, well, it's not very manly. So you're telling me Jesus isn't manly? That's very manly. Not to take vengeance on evil. You know why? Vengeance is not our department. That's God's department. I'll say more about that in just a minute. But can I say this? Vengeance is the way of man. That's what man likes to do, is take vengeance. In fact, you heard the man who now our president will say during the primary, if somebody hits me, I'm going to hit them back twice as hard. And he's remained true to that philosophy. In 1992, the wife of a famous British aristocrat found out that he had been cheating on her. So she decided to get even. She began by pouring many gallons of paint inside his cherished BMW. Then she went to his suit closet, which had 32 tailor-made suits in it. She cut the left sleeve off of each of the suits. That made news. And so other people started writing the paper about their ideas. Women wrote in saying, I think you ought to clean the toilet with his toothbrush. Or one lady in Switzerland said, she decided, she wrote in that she's going to show her husband by committing suicide in front of him. She waited till he was on the sidewalk beneath their third floor balcony, and she jumped right at that moment. Oh, she survived because she landed on him and killed him. The Bible makes it clear retaliation is never what the Christian's about. That's never the Christian thing to do. Is there somebody you're thinking about payback? Is there somebody you think about you'd like to hurt like they've hurt you? Don't retaliate when you've been wronged. Let me give you a couple scriptures. Jot down, if you will, 1 Peter 3:9. 1 Peter 3:9. 1 Peter 3:9 says this. Not rendering evil for evil, or railing for railing, but contrariwise, blessing, knowing that ye are thereunto called, that ye should inherit a blessing. And by the way, it's interesting, in the passage in 1 Peter chapter 3, the context that that's in is the context of a husband and a wife. Verse 7 was, husbands, dwell with him according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel. And then verse 9 comes up with, not rendering evil for evil or railing for railing, but contrariwise blessing, knowing that ye are thereunto called, that you should inherit a blessing. So what do you do when there's evil for evil? You give them a blessing. We'll tell you more about that in a minute. But you don't repay. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, 1 Thessalonians 5 and verse number 15 says this, see that none render evil for evil unto any man, but ever follow that which is good both among yourselves and to all men. Why shouldn't we try to repay a wrong? Let me give you three quick reasons. Number one, it'll cause the conflict to escalate. Proverbs 30 and verse 33 says this, surely the churning of milk bringeth forth butter, and the wringing of the nose bringeth forth blood, so the forcing of wrath bringeth forth strife. You try to handle things yourself, you're usually going to escalate it. And things are going to get ugly, as they say. Okay? Number two, retaliation is usually excessive. We usually pay back, but it's with interest. Like Donald Trump said, I'll hit you back and it'll be twice as hard. It'll be more than what's needed. And then, by the way, thirdly, retaliation always ruins our witness. It always ruins your testimony. What are you supposed to do then? Somebody wrongs you. You can't return evil. You can't take vengeance. What are you supposed to do? You know what you're supposed to do? You're supposed to forgive. You're supposed to forgive. Forgiveness doesn't absolve anybody of blame, and it doesn't clear the offender's record with God. But it clears you of having to worry about how you're going to punish them. It clears you when you forgive them. You're not turning them loose. You're turning them over to God. And letting God deal with them His way and in His time. You'd be amazed when you do that and you say, God, I'm letting them go. I'm putting them in Your hands. I'm putting this whole thing in Your hands. I'm done. It's going to be You. People do that and they do it from their heart. You know what they say? Like a weight was lifted off my shoulders. Wow. How wonderful I felt. It's almost like getting saved all over again. The weight that you carried of carrying that person and carrying that wrong and thinking on it is lifted. The prison house is flooded with light. And for the first time in a long time, you'll have peace that comes to your heart. And you're free. You just release the anger. And you release any time under punishment. Because you're saying, I'm going to leave that with God. Vengeance is His. He will repay. I'll just leave that up to God. Relinquish the revenge to God. It's so normal. It's so human to want to hurt those who've hurt us. Hurting people hurt people. You've heard it said. It's true. But the Lord calls us in Romans 12 and other scriptures here that we are to live differently as believers. We don't follow that pattern. Vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. God has called us to be peacemakers, not prosecutors. We don't exact justice on people who've wronged us. That's God's department, not ours. Revenge goes beyond getting even. Revenge often is excessive retribution. Here's three reasons why we leave vengeance to God. Because number one, God alone judges righteously. God alone judges righteously. Because we don't know all the variables. And I'll tell you what you don't know. You do not know somebody else's heart. Man looks on the outward appearance, God sees the heart. Doesn't mean God doesn't look on the outside appearance, He does. But God also can see inside that you and I can't see. I know we say that sometimes. Well, I know what they were thinking. No, you don't. Not unless they told you. You don't have that ability, neither do I. And by the way, neither does Satan. Satan doesn't read your mind. That's why it's so important you don't verbalize things that you shouldn't verbalize. Because then Satan hears it and he knows what to do. He'll come after you. Number two, no one is going to get away with anything. That's why we leave it to God. No one's going to get away with anything. God will make sure justice is done. It'll be in His way. It'll be in His time. But He will not overlook anything. We obviously can. We'll forget things. We can overlook things. God won't. And number three, the reason we leave vengeance with God is a God of judgment, but he's also a God of mercy. Aren't you glad God is a God of mercy? There'd be a whole lot fewer people in the room tonight if God wasn't a God of mercy. And we thank him for his mercy, that in judgment he has mercy. Just as God extended mercy to us, we extend that mercy to others. Talked about that in Sunday school on Sunday. We're kind of like, if we're not careful, we can get like Jonah. God is merciful to the Ninevites and they repent and God forgives them and God doesn't judge them. And how's Jonah react to that? He's mad. He wanted God to burn him up. He wanted to see that judgment. And so we have to, when God's merciful, let's us be. Listen, I don't want to see retaliation on my enemies. I want to see redemption on my enemies. I want to see them come to Christ. I want to see them be right with God. So don't seek vengeance. Recompense to no man evil for evil. Number three. So what are we supposed to do? We don't render evil for evil. We don't seek vengeance for evil. You know what we do? We overcome evil with good. With good. Overcome is a word that means to mightily prevail over, to master, or to be victorious. And in every situation, we have a choice. We can either be a victor or a victim, or we can be a victor. I'm afraid in many cases, and many Christians, instead of being overcomers, they're succumbers. And they just succumb to whatever happens. And listen, if you think this is difficult, say, man, I mean, when evil, I have to do good? That sounds hard. That sounds really hard. In fact, and can I tell you, it isn't just hard, it's impossible without God. In fact, when I was writing out this third point, I was writing in a little 3x5 card as I was thinking about it, and I misspelled the last word. I put, you have to overcome evil with, and I left out an O, and I wrote God. And I thought, boy, that's pretty good too. And by the way, you don't get good without God. And you can't do it without God. If it's just us, we're going the evil for evil route. And we're going the payback route. That's how man does it. It's not how God does it. If evil for evil is devil-like, and good for good is man-like, then good for evil must be God-like. And it is. Look, who lives in us? Jesus Christ. The one who overcame evil. The one who, when he was reviled, reviled not again. He trusted himself to the one that judges righteously. And even when he was mocked on the cross, and they spit in his face, and he looked at them and said, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. Overcome evil with good. Somebody says, man, preacher, that never works in everyday life. Absolutely. Listen, Christian, we're called to a higher standard than those who don't know Christ. The standard that the world goes by is not our standard. We're called to a higher standard. There's the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. It doesn't just teach passive non-resistance when evil is done to us. It teaches us active resistance. goodness to our enemies. Overcome evil with good. Direct and overt acts of kindness. In other words, somebody does me wrong, I'm not just to forgive it, I'm to do something good for them in return. Wow. That's what he's teaching. Somebody slanders you or treats you unkindly, you go out of your way to try to serve them. If your enemy's hungry, feed them. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. If he's naked, clothe them. So I might feel sorry for him, but I'm not sure helping him. Let somebody else do that. That's not what he teaches. That's not our standard. That's not what he's holding forth here for us. According to the Scripture, if your enemy hungers, you feed them. Don't say, somebody will. No, you. You do something good for them. Not, I hope somebody will give them something to drink. No, you give them something to drink. You give the blessing for the curse. You give a favor for the wrong. When Judas came to betray Jesus, what did Jesus do? He kissed him on the cheek and called him friend. He illustrated what he was trying to teach his disciples. He could have, he just picked the guy's ear up and put it back on his head. He could have just spoke the word and all those guys would have been dead as a doornail. He had that power, but he didn't do it. See, that's God. Listen, I know that's like I said, that's not just hard. If you know it's hard, it's hard if you're trying to self-effort it up. You better ask God to help you. You better ask the Spirit of God to help you. One of the fruit of the Spirit is goodness. Better ask the Spirit of God to help you with this, or you won't make it. If Christ is your master, you must do what he says to do. Amen? When we return good for evil, it preserves us from the evil. If I fight the evil with good, then it cannot hurt me. If somebody curses me and I answer him with a blessing, then it's clear the curse has not hurt me. It hasn't controlled me. It hasn't gotten into me. If the curse gets to me, you know what I start doing? I start cursing as well. I give out what I've taken in. Someone may slander you, but if you don't return that slander, if you don't return those words, then he hasn't got your real character. The dirt they've thrown has missed you. And it's not affecting you. Because you have none to throw back at him. When someone provokes your temper and you remain calm and quiet, then their arrow has passed by you. And you haven't caught it and loaded it up and shooting it back at him. You see, the very thing that Satan would like, the very thing the enemy would like, would be to get us to go to their level and do evil for evil. Nothing. You ever, husband, wives, any other relationships, you ever have somebody who wanted to have an argument and the other one wouldn't argue? That's frustrating. Huh? Some of you have been there, I can tell. Let them say, come on, say something. They sit there and look at you. That's maddening. That's The enemy wants you to get on their level. I think when we return good for evil, we bring great honor to Christ. I don't think anything that would touch the eyes of the world as much as this would. When they see that we won't return evil for evil, but we return good for evil. To repay good for evil is to overcome evil with good. Isn't that what Jesus did when he died on the cross? It's God's masterpiece of overcoming evil with good. His love and his grace for the sin of mankind. I read this, I like this quote. We are the disciples of him who died for his enemies. We are the disciples of him who died for his enemies. None of us would be saved if Christ didn't die for his enemies. Because we were the enemies of Christ before we were saved. Wow. If he hadn't loved the enemies and overcome our evil by his good, we wouldn't know salvation tonight. So, Jesus, as always, is our example. He's our motivation for what we do, and he's the only way we can do it. But we get into ourselves, we'll be like David was. By the way, David, to finish that story, if some of you don't know it, Abigail appeased him, and he was real impressed with her. It's raining hard. You don't want to go home yet anyway, so just sit tight. Was that last Sunday night, or was it Wednesday night it was raining so hard? Was it Sunday night? Last Wednesday night. Okay, so just sit tight. You're not going anywhere. And so he didn't go up. He let Nabal into God's hands. Nabal got drunk. And that night, you read about it in 1 Samuel 25, God made his heart like a stone. And he died. God took care of it. David didn't have to. And David's name, his reputation, his testimony, all of that stayed intact because he let God take care of it. Tonight, you have to make a choice. And this is what's interesting. You either will overcome evil with good, or you will be overcome of evil. You have to make the choice. Which is it going to be? You need to take a step this week to do something kind towards the person that you're struggling with. The one who you may consider to be an enemy. Could be a kind word. Might be a phone call. Could be an email. Could be a text message, might be a flower, might be a meal, might be a small gift. Could be a package of Oreos. Now don't do that, then I'll know you're mad at me about something, all right? But you know, you overcome evil with good. Don't be overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good. No alternative. No neutrality, no middle ground. You either overcome evil with good or you're overcome of evil. Let's be not overcome of evil. Let's overcome evil with good. Let's stand together and we'll have prayer. Father, thank you for this evening. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Lord, there's so much that we could cover with this subject. Thank you, Lord, for showing us the example. Thank you, Jesus, for living in us. And the life that we now live in the flesh, we live by the faith of the Son of God who loved us and gave himself for us. Christ liveth in me. Oh, what a salvation this, that Christ liveth in me. And I pray, God, that we would allow you to live in us and through us. We can't follow this command in our own strength, in our own power. We need you to help us. And so I pray that each of us tonight, Lord, would yield to thy Spirit and the fruit of the Spirit, which is goodness, that we could overcome evil with good. That when someone curses us, we can bless them. When they form that alliance to bring evil to us, we will do good to them. And we will reflect on how good Jesus Christ has been to us. Amen. That will motivate us to live as he lived. Dismiss us now with your care, Lord. Watch over us as we go home, and some will drive through the rain. I pray you'll give them safety. Lord, we ask that others would see Christ in us. I pray that those in the room who have someone that they need to let go, not to let go free, to let go and put in your control, that they'd release them to you tonight and allow you to deal with them. And day by day, as we see evil happen, and sometimes it comes to us, that we would respond by doing good. Help us to be overcomers. And we'll thank you for it. We pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. All right. Let's sing together. The windows of heaven are open. The blessings are falling tonight. It's 128 in the book if you need it. Let's sing that together. All right. Here we go. The windows of heaven are open. The blessings are falling tonight. There's joy, joy, joy in my heart since Jesus made everything right. I gave him my old tattered garments. He gave me a robe of pure white. I'm feasting on manna from heaven. That's why I'm happy. That's why you're happy. That's why we're happy tonight. God bless you. You're dismissed. Choir, come right on up.